Noobs.
The beginning of something special, which is where we are right now. So I wanted to, first of all, thank you, Morgan, for coming and talking with me. I found the name of the show. All right, are you ready?
Tell me what you All right, about. The show has a name.
Yeah,
let's give it.
The show has a name. I think it's very catchy. It's called Learn to Kill Your Party with This Underrated Monster, featuring our guest expert. What do you think?
It's not exactly snappy, but I'm sure it is.
It isn't. Well, there's an acronym. There's an acronym.
Right.
So maybe that'll help.
Oh.
Yeah, it's L2KYPWTUMFOGE. So maybe that's a little catchier. Probably not.
It's also a bit of a misnomer because it does seem to imply that I am somehow an expert.
Oh, you very much so are an expert, and that's specifically why you're here, right? Because I want to give you I want to give everybody a little bit of the backstory. So I was, as I'm wont to do, browsing the dregs of Reddit, which is like the bottom most part of the internet that you could ever find yourself in. Of course, I'm being facetious, but nonetheless, I find this ridiculous post on an underrated monster about the Bargeist, and I read it, and I kept reading it, and then I read it like three more times. And I was like, who did this? Like, it was a masterpiece. I had never read something as well put together, as thought out, as thorough, and like entertaining as those posts. And I searched through this guy's post history. There's like 10 of them. Everything is quality. So by my account, and I'm the only one that matters, you are specifically an expert. So, Morgan, thank you.
Well, I will take that compliment.
Yeah, I mean, thank you for taking the time. I know there's a big time difference, but thanks for taking the time to talk with me today.
Hey, no problem. This is going to be fun because
I get to do
my favorite thing, which is talk to people about D&D.
Damn right. Yeah, I mean, I think it's a great opportunity to shed some light not only on this really, I mean, interesting monster, but like, yeah, just to sit down and chat about nerd shit. It's great, right? So yeah, why don't you take some time, tell me about yourself for a little bit before we dive into the creature.
Well, I've been DMing for almost 2 years now. It's not that long in the grand scheme of things, but I have always been fascinated with these monsters.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess in a way I've also always been fascinated about what their stat blocks say about the creature itself, its personality and its lore.
Yeah.
Because when you really dig into it, even small changes, even small little features can tell you so much about a creature's personality,
right,
and how it operates. You know, there are a lot of creatures in this game that are very similar, and there are some that look similar but aren't. And I think, especially when I was writing about the Bargeist and, you know, all these other creatures that I didn't think got the credit they deserved,
yeah,
it's because these are the things that enthralled me. I was thinking, the stories I could run with this,
right,
the things I could do to my players, the suffering I could inflict upon them.
There you go. That's what it all boils down to, is how can I use this to torture my friends and associates?
Absolutely. But it's when you see these things that, I mean, I don't mean to dig at dragons and hags and mind flayers and all these classic baddies, because they're classic for a reason.
Right.
They're really nice, and I've definitely used them. Well, I've used the hags. Dragons are a work in progress. But when these creatures get overlooked,
mm-hmm,
I think that players and DMs alike are really missing out,
yeah,
on something, creatures that could make their games really unique and special.
Yeah, I mean, I find myself, like, when I'm looking for something or a hook or something like that, I default to a hag, I default to something, like, I throw a dragon, because it's, you know, I'm familiar with it, comfortable with it, I've seen it everywhere, the players are familiar with it. But sometimes I think putting something in the game that the players aren't familiar with makes it fun for them. And if the monster has this cool lore or these cool capabilities or something interesting and unique about them, it's fun for you as a DM too to be able to run that.
Absolutely. And some monsters are in themselves just by existing or some aspect of their stats or their lore have these really nice plot hooks built into them. You know, I think one of the monsters I covered was an Alep. Reddit posts. Mm-hmm. And the mere fact of his existence, that it has been torn apart and destroyed by forbidden knowledge.
Knowledge, yep.
That in of itself is, how can you not work with that?
Yeah. I mean, it is infinite, you know. And how many times have you seen an Alep? I've never seen one in a game. I've tried to use one, and the players never figured it out. they never figured it out.
I used one.
Did you?
I used one a couple of weeks before I wrote that post.
Okay.
And again, it confused the players utterly. One player teleported through a keyhole into the room. Mm-hmm. I tried to talk to it and couldn't make sense out of it. And when the initiative was rolled, the rest of the party found out they could hurt them through the walls. And again, it was nothing like what they'd seen. And right. I just love to draw attention to monsters like that.
Yeah.
Because I love them. I know other people will too.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I think that's a great segue. So today we're talking about the Wood Woad. The Wood Woad. That is, first of all, I'm sure that's a monster that very few people are, if they're familiar with it, certainly not in depth. I think looking at, literally, when we talked about setting this up, I looked at a Wood Woad, I looked at the picture, I glanced at the stat block, I was like, that's dope, let's do this. And I don't know anything. I know woad is a plant, and I know it's a dye. I know those two things.
Okay.
So that's what I know about that. And I know what wood is, too. I know wood. That word. What do you got for me on basics with it?
Right, so on its basic level, the Wood Woad is a medium plant creature. Mm-hmm. Again, it is vaguely humanoid in shape. It's made of wood. It looks like an ambulatory tree stump wielding a shield in one hand and a club in the other.
Okay.
It is, however, the product of some really dark magic.
Nice.
Human sacrifice, to be precise.
Ah!
The
that's
sacrifice's
the best
heart.
Kind of sacrifice. That is
sacrifice's heart is cut out of its chest.
Okay.
Placed in a tree hollow, and that tree's roots are bathed in blood. And sometimes the same person's blood. And then the wood ward will sprout from the ground at the base of this tree sometime later, as a perfectly obedient guardian. Now, this is pretty grim stuff, but it's important to note that the wood ward is not evil.
Really?
It is a lawful neutral creature that can have perfectly benign intentions. It is, however, perfectly obedient to whoever made it.
Right.
I think we'll talk in a bit about what kind of people might make a wood ward,
right,
because it is a really brutal thing to do. You might not be able to properly imagine a good aligned creature doing something like this, absolutely can, and they will.
Really?
Again, I will get back to that much later on.
Yeah. Keep going.
Right, so the other important thing about woodwards is they are immortal. They will not die of old age. They can be killed.
Sure.
But they are immortal, and again, part of the plot hooks inherent to them is that they can outlive their own creator, which can, of course, leave them free. Normally, they are bound to the will of whatever purpose they were created to serve. And
right.
Normally, they're guardians and bodyguards of specific places or people.
Right.
Normally, places connected to nature.
Sure, makes sense.
Yeah. I think it's a good time to look at the Wood Woad's features.
Yeah, please.
Because it's got some features you wouldn't expect.
Right.
You will need a Volo's Guide to Monsters.
Okay.
Do you want to... You want to open up a copy, or you just want to?
Yeah, I'm gonna pull it up and put it on the stream here so everybody can see it.
Sure thing. Because for people who have only really skimmed Volo's guide, mm-hmm. there's some interesting details here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so hit him up. What do we got?
Right, so first and foremost, you will notice that the Woodwolf, out of its basic ability scores, the Woodwolf's highest stats are Strength and Constitution. Its Dexterity and Wisdom bonuses are nominal, and its lowest and only negative stat is Charisma. This guy is a good melee fighter, he's good at standing out in the fray, but he's not chatty.
Right, yeah, well, which makes sense, you know.
Yes. And this is a quite a deceptive set of ability scores. Again, I will get to this. There is a bit to unpack here. Now, the Woodwood has good armor. It's got an armor class of 18, which is really respectable.
Yeah, that's great. That's really good.
He is a tough cookie. I mean, he is literally made of wood. And to complement that, he is resistant to bludgeoning and piercing damage, but not slashing damage. So axes are all okay.
Makes sense. Okay. At first I thought longsword. Why the hell axe? Yeah, makes sense. Perfect.
Well, he's a tree, isn't he?
Right, yeah. Perfect.
He is vulnerable to fire. He's vulnerable to fire damage, but he's also got another weakness to fire. You see, his hit points, mm-hmm. I mean, 75 hit points, is not that much for a CR5 creature.
No.
But he does have 10 points of regeneration per turn. Now, of course, 3 rounds of combat, if he gets to regenerate every turn, he basically has 105 hit points, right, which is a bit more like it.
Yeah.
However, fire damage is not only weak to it, but it prevents him from regenerating.
Which cripples so, it.
Yes, basically. Mm-hmm. It doesn't quite cripple it because the Woodward's got more tricks than that.
Okay.
It is not that easy.
Okay.
You see, one of the other strong features that the Woodward has for a melee combatant is its magic weapon. Its club is a magic weapon that deals bonus damage and, well, deals magical bludgeoning damage.
Right. Sure.
And he also has 2 condition immunities, okay, and they're very interesting ones. They are charmed and frightened. Now, when I see a creature that is immune to being charmed and frightened, this tells me that this is a creature that cannot be dissuaded from what it was meant to do.
Yep.
It has a purpose. You cannot trick it or frighten it away from that purpose under any circumstances. It is unyielding. So it doesn't really matter that his wisdom score isn't very good because right, he's already immune to the thing that wisdom normally protects you against.
Most of the things that you're casting on something is a wisdom save, right? Charmed, fear, those are both whiz. So yeah, makes a lot of sense.
Again, however, dexterity is also not great, and fire is typically a dexterity save.
Sure. Fireball, is that a good spell? I don't know. People barely use it. People very rarely use
it. I think I've heard of it. yeah, so again, if you're planning on using a wood guild against your path, you need to think in advance. Yeah, do I have any pyromaniacs in the party?
Right, yeah. Are they fireball first kind of people?
Yeah. Now, we are not done with the Woodward's basic features. Mm-hmm. We are not even moving on to actions just yet.
Good.
See, the Woodward also has another thing that I really like in creatures.
Okay.
And that's skill proficiencies. I think skill proficiencies are one of the most informative things you can possibly have as a DM when running a monster encounter.
I couldn't agree with you more.
For example, like, it's... A lot of creatures have proficiency in perception and stealth, or one of them. And again, predators tend to have that.
Right.
And that tells you that they're a predator,
like
for example.
An ambush predator would be able to have both of those things and be good at them.
Exactly. Now, very few creatures have something like Arcana proficiency. Mm-hmm. And you might not think, well, that's not useful for running an encounter. Well, it is, mm-hmm. because that determines when you're role-playing the monster, how they treat magic and spellcasters.
Sure.
A creature with Arcana proficiency can be reliably depend on them knowing that concentration spells are a thing,
yep,
or to recognize certain spells,
and
you know,
effects that are affecting them and their companions. Yep.
Yeah. So that's why I really love how skill proficiencies inform the running of a monster.
That's a great point. You know, I feel like a lot of people don't look at that. They see skill proficiencies and they're like, why do I care if this thing knows about religion? I just want to beat him with a club, you know? And well, yeah, you can, but that's a good point.
Yeah. The Woodward has three skill proficiencies. Mm-hmm. Athletics, perception, and stealth.
Okay. There you go.
These all say something very interesting, because it's dexterity and wisdom bonuses are plus one. Mm-hmm. So its skills in that aspect come entirely from its proficiency. Mm-hmm. Perception, it's not a hunter. It doesn't need to hunt. It's a plant. It can dig into the soil and absorb nutrients that way.
Okay.
This is because it is a watch one. It is a guard, a sentinel.
Yep.
And this is to protect things from sneaking past it. But what about its stealth?
Yeah, that's strange.
We will get back to that.
That's very interesting. Okay.
Now, athletics complements its best stat, strength.
Right.
And you got to consider, what is athletics really used for? Well, in chases, it's used to avoid exhaustion. So right. If a Woodward is chasing you, it can keep chasing you.
Yep.
Again, it is unrelenting, just like its condition immunities imply. Athletics is good for climbing, and the Woodward has a 30-foot climbing speed to complement its walking speed.
Interesting.
So that is interesting. You wouldn't expect this big, stocky warrior to be climbing about in the trees, right, but that is exactly what a Woodward will do.
That's awesome.
And of course, grappling and shoving. Now, remember, it is lawful, neutral, and may be in service to a good aligned creature. Mm-hmm. So, if it was protecting a sacred site, for example, is it going to go straight for the bonk, or is it going to grapple or shove you outside of the protected area,
yeah,
as perhaps as a warning, and then like escalate to bludgeoning?
Yeah, well, it's not a stupid creature, you know. So it is
absolutely not. It's got an intelligence 10 and a wisdom 13.
Yeah.
It's not stupid. It is smarter than average.
Yeah, it's smart enough to know the difference and to know. So those athletics proficiencies do speak a lot about how that creature would operate. I think the climb speed is super interesting. I think that's super interesting.
Yes. It's got a couple of other features that helps it with climbing and incentivizes it to climb.
Okay.
Now, the other thing athletics is good for is resisting grappling and shoving.
Right.
Again, this is because it is an unrelenting creature. If it is going after someone, it is very difficult to stop.
Yep.
If it's going to charge at the backline casters slinging fireballs around, and the frontline fighter thinking, oh no, you're not going near my sorcerer, mm-hmm, he's going to have a hard time persuading it not to.
Yep, absolutely. Either by magic or with physicality.
Yeah,
you know
exactly. So players, I find, don't use often grappling that much.
Right.
But of course, once you get to the higher tier of the game, you've got abilities that can grapple, that can shove, stuff like the Shield Master feat, spells that can conjure elementals and demons and whatnot that might have grappling features.
Right.
It starts to factor in then.
Yeah.
But the Woodward is hard to stop. Let's move on to that stealth proficiency.
Yes.
Because the Woodward is a ninja.
Really?
That is not an exaggeration.
Okay.
It has got a suite of features that is perfectly in line with what a Way of Shadows monk might have.
Okay. Hell yeah.
So, first of all, it is proficient in stealth, and it's good at climbing, so it's going to be up a tree.
Right.
But it has plant camouflage, which gives it advantage on stealth checks.
Oh, wow.
As long as there's enough obscuring plant life around.
Right.
Again, this is a creature that's highly incentivized to stay around trees. It's not just enough to be a tree.
Right.
It's got to be around trees at all time.
Yeah.
So it's good at climbing. It's good at stealth. It has advantage when it's around trees. It's got perception proficiency.
Oh,
so
yeah.
When it's guarding a site or it's following something going through protected territory,
mm-hmm,
it's going to be moving treetop to treetop.
Yep. And with that feature too, there's very few times where it's not going to have that advantage because of where it is, right? When is it not going to be around enough plant life?
You need a tree to make the damn thing.
Right, yeah, exactly. It's not going to be the one lonely tree sitting in a field, they turn it into a woodwood and he just stands there, you know, yeah.
Yeah, it has got one other feature,
mm-hmm,
that really sells this.
Mm-hmm.
That really brings home all of its abilities in stealth and in combat and makes it really effective. Mm-hmm. And that is Tree Stride.
Oh, that's a great ability.
It can use 10 feet of movement to enter a large or bigger tree within 5 feet of it, and then teleport within 5 feet of another tree that's within 60 feet of it.
That's huge.
That is huge. So it's not just going to be climbing treetop to treetop. Mm-hmm. It is going to be teleporting treetop to treetop.
Which is amazing.
It's good for stealth. It's good for combat. I'd go as far as to say it's a waste of a woodward if you don't run it in heavily forested terrain.
Right.
If you make a battle map that involves for a woodward encounter, you want trees everywhere.
Yeah.
Because that is how... Well, if you don't, then why are you using a woodward?
Right, yeah. Yeah, I mean, right now you're saying that, and I'm picturing, like, the thing has 30 feet of climb, right? So, theoretically, it could... It sees a party, right? It sees your party. The party approaches it. It notices you. We'll say it's even on the ground, right? So it climbs about 20 feet up a tree and then uses the last 10 feet of its movement to tree stride. And they have no idea where that thing went. They have no idea where that thing went. And it's not like you're coming out at the base of the tree, right? You don't have to. You could be at the middle of the tree, you could be at the top of the tree, you could be at the bottom. He could stay in the same tree. You know, that's sick. That's awesome.
It is really cool. Very nice feature. I think that this feature, more than any of the others, I'm not going to say more than any of the others, because it has a very complementary list of features. I think when we was planning this, I dropped some hints saying, oh, it's a creature of two parts. It's like two different creatures melded together. But it's not actually a very complementary suite of abilities. It's not a long stat block. It's not a complicated stat block. Right. But some of the best rarely are.
Right.
And again, it does have that fire weakness. And I'm going to go as far as to say that your players are going to need that.
Sure. Yeah. Just to even hem it down. I mean, because it seems like the movement capabilities on this alone are huge.
Yeah. I mean... What's the default strategy of any D&D party? You got your snipers and your casters at the back, and then you got your martial classes. They run up front to tie up the enemy. But it's the casters and the snipers. They're going to be the most likely to have fire damage, and the woodward, being an intelligent creature, knows it's weak to fire,
and it
will home in on them. And with its only action is a two-hit multi-attack with its club.
Right.
Tree stride doesn't cost it its action or its bonus action. That is just movement.
Awesome. Which is awesome.
It's only got one thing it can do a turn, which is club or grapple, I suppose. Right. Since it has got athletics proficiency, I'm going to say it might try to grapple.
Right.
But again, it can tree stride past your barbarian, past your paladin, and straight into your wizard.
Yeah.
And say, so you think you can throw fireballs in my forest?
Right. I mean that's great.
It's pretty scary. I think there's some very interesting story potential, because when you set up a combat encounter, there's very often the opportunity to tell a story with that encounter to set the tone. You can really set the mood of a session or a campaign arc with the combat.
Right. I agree 100%.
And the woodward is a very mysterious creature. Again, it's stealthy, it's strange, and it can appear from... It looks weird. Mm-hmm. Its shield is part of its arm, you know? It looks like an old stump with two little eyes peering out from inside of it. You're not really sure what to expect, but it can appear from nowhere, and it can return to nowhere.
Right.
And that is going to make your players paranoid. Absolutely. If a woodward... leave an encounter alive, they're going to be scared.
Yeah, absolutely. Even if it's, in the middle of the combat, right? It, because of the way that it... Now, does it... I may be jumping ahead, but does it communicate with its creator? Is it capable of doing so?
Its stat block doesn't give it any specific ability to do so, neither does lore text. Mm-hmm. However, it is an intelligent creature, so I don't see why you couldn't use sending stones, for example.
Sure.
And if it was aligned with a spellcaster, and again, that's something I want to talk about in a bit, I don't see why they couldn't use their magic to communicate with it magically. Right. So stuff like animal messenger, sending, the usual.
Yeah, because I'm also now kind of picturing this thing, them crossing some kind of threshold, and this thing attacking them, just out of nature, right? Out of its nature to attack them, it gets a message, hey, come back, these guys are fine, or whatever the case might be. And then it just goes back in the tree and the party's like, what the hell just happened? You know?
Yes, indeed. I think another good thing to do with this is to ramp up the tension a bit. I like to do this with my combat encounters when the enemies have stealth proficiency. Mm-hmm. And that is, if an enemy fails a stealth roll, it doesn't just give away its position immediately, unless it's sneaking up on someone to do a backstab.
Sure.
If it's just watching, the players will just catch a glimpse of something out of the corner of their eyes or get the vague hint of what's following them.
Right.
And of course, the woodward, it looks like a tree. It has plant camouflage.
Right.
So if it does roll badly, even with advantage, you can just tell your players, you see there's something shifting up in the trees. It looks like possibly the branches of the trees themselves are moving in some strange, unnatural way. But as you watch now, it's gone, because of course, it'll tree stride away.
Right, yeah, that's awesome. That's super clever. I like that a lot.
So, and the thing is, forests can be a very difficult terrain to navigate for players. It's full of undergrowth that can be difficult terrain, mm-hmm. trees of course that block line of sight, that can block sunlight with a thick enough canopy. Mm-hmm. You got like hills, rocks, boulders, lakes and streams and rivers. All these things can impede player movement, impede their sight lines, make them easy to sneak up on. It doesn't do any of that for a woodward. The forest can only help the woodward.
It makes them faster. It makes them better.
It makes them faster. It makes them more dangerous. Mm-hmm. And more importantly, it drives home to the players that they are somewhere they don't belong.
Right.
That they are in something else's territory.
Oh, that's great.
And when the players are storming a dungeon, they can often feel like they're slowly conquering the dungeon. And that's a good feeling. Mm-hmm. But if you want to put your players on the back foot to make them feel like they don't belong here,
right,
that they need, and that the further they go in, the more danger they'll be in. But the enemy has a distinct advantage and they can't just conquer it as they go along. Mm-hmm. Woodwards can do that.
That's
because they are masters of the forest.
Yeah, that's, I mean, honestly, that is, I remember when we first talked about doing this, I said, hey, my players are going into a forest, you know, let's talk about forest monsters, right? And that was precisely the thing that I attempted to do with them, was that, you know, the trees were things were coming. They had no idea what was going on. And that was the foreign, it's like an alien territory that's in their backyard. You know, I think it's powerful. And especially with a creature like the woodwoad that has this rich lore, utilizing that in addition to, the lore, utilizing its capabilities, it's a win. I think that's awesome.
Actually, you know, since you bring up the lore, why don't we talk about that? Because there's some nice story hooks in that as well.
Sure.
So,
please.
Edginess in D&D is something that's very often looked upon with derision. You know, it's often associated with new players or mm-hmm. younger people coming into the game. Mm-hmm. We've all been there. We've made very edgy characters.
Yeah.
But a little bit of edge used responsibly, much like alcohol, can be a recipe for a good time.
that is a good line.
Yes. And woodwoods have that bit of edge to them. They are made of like a grotesque human sacrifice ritual where you cut out someone's heart and bathe the plant in blood. And
it's not like you can donate your organs to be a woodwoad. You know, like,
well, that's just it. You sort of can. Obviously, you have to die,
right.
But there's nothing to say you can't be a willing sacrifice.
Okay.
And this is why I bring up edge, because sometimes you feel that there is some aspect of your forest where that isn't quite edgy enough. With benevolent fae creatures, druids, treants, creatures like that, it can be often too easy to write them as just being tree huggers, right, as being nice and harmony with lots of fluffy animal friends.
Little squirrels, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it can be hard to think, okay, hang on now. I didn't want to make these guys the unequivocal good guys. What do I do? And that's where you want to lean into the fact that nature can be a brutal, savage, uncaring force of nature. And the woodward can really sell that brutality, the uncompromising nature of druid factions. Right. You know, if you wanted a benevolent druid circle to be protecting a forest, but wanted to add a little callous edge to them to show that they have a slightly different alien priorities to what the players might have, then the Woodward could be a good way of doing that to show.
Absolutely.
Yes, this guy here, he used to be one of us. He willingly, when he was on his deathbed, participated in this grotesque ritual to become this creature.
To cut his heart out and eternally guard this forest.
Yes, exactly. And that's something that might seem strange to the players. The players might feel that their characters have earned a peaceful death after their adventures are done.
Right.
But to a an Oath of Ancients paladin, a druid, a nature cleric, a particularly devoted ranger, people like these, this could be a viable option.
Yeah.
To continue the quest.
That is a great point. You know, I feel like it. You know, it's used in other mediums and other fantasy worlds as well, where someone will be like cast. Usually it's into a suit of armor, right? Like, it's usually cast into, like, their spirit is put inside this walking tank and they will eternally guard their country or whatever the case might be. There's a lot of different aspects of other games that do that. And the Woodwode, I think, takes that and doesn't make it benevolent or malevolent. It just gives you that tool. Say, hey, here you go. Put this in wherever you think it would fit.
Absolutely. That is, yes, you're right. It just gives you the tool. Of course, the Woodwood can be used maliciously. It's only the default language is Sylvan. I mean, I could easily see a Woodwood knowing Elvish, Druidic, but Sylvan, again, is perfectly fitting. And that brings to mind evil fae, hags, namely. We talked about them earlier. We all love hags. Yes. But Woodwoods make for a good hag minion because it's dark and gruesome and kind of frightening.
That's a great hook. That's awesome. Yeah, that's a very unique, I think, take on that, right? Because you wouldn't assume, but this hag could absolutely know that ritual that you would need to perform, and she's doing it. And there are trees around her swamp cottage or whatever the thing might be.
Yeah, exactly. And another thing I really like in monsters is something that gives an interesting scene for the players to come across.
Right.
Now, in some of the creatures I posted about on Reddit, I give the Burbalang as an example of this. Mm-hmm. Because when you come across a Burbalang's lair, it is littered in bones that are etched in writings of strange languages that maybe only a handful of people in the world know.
No. Yep.
This is an interesting thing for the players to come across, even if the monster isn't even there.
Right.
And the Woodwood does that too. Like, this ritual isn't a quick one. It takes time for this thing to sprout.
Mm-hmm.
So the players could easily come across like a grove of trees that are all waiting to sprout up Woodwoods.
Oh, wow.
You know, they see that strange charms, possibly made of animal bones or human bones, are strung from the trees with writing in Sylvan or Druidic, like, you know, woven into the bark, where someone has used a druidcraft spell to mold the bark itself into these strange symbols. And they look into these brown stained hollows around the trees to find a mummified human heart cradled in there. They've just trespassed upon a ritual site, and you know, it's the old hook. Oh, you've trespassed upon a dark magic ritual. You got to fight something now.
Right, yeah. And it just so happens, you know, it can teleport from tree to tree, and you have no idea where it is. So good luck.
Yes. Again, so this is where the bit of edge comes in. The edge here is a very powerful tool when used responsibly.
Right.
Because a plant creature you wouldn't normally associate as being very gory or horrifying, but the Woodwood is.
Right. Yeah,
it's scary in this kind of gross, and there's a bit of darkness behind its creation, but it's also scary at how it operates, as in it's mysterious, and the fear of the unknown, of course, is
right.
Because if a Woodwood retreats from a battle before you kill it, and you could see it regenerating in the middle of battle,
you know,
then how tough You know it's fine, but you don't even know how tough it is.
Right. Yeah, that's a great point too. Yeah.
You don't know, okay, did we just give it a slap on the wrist or did we come close to killing it? You
Yeah.
don't know.
You have no idea. The less information the players have, the scarier it is, right? The less
Yeah, and the
information the
fact.
player has about the monsters in particular.
Absolutely. And the fact that the Woodward's one default language, Sylvan, isn't very commonly spoken, and also the fact he simply chooses not to speak very often, as evidenced in its lore text right here,
Yeah.
and the fact it shows no mercy
Right.
and cannot be negotiated with, it has a purpose.
Right.
That in of itself makes the Woodward even more mysterious. You don't know what
Right.
it wants.
Right.
Uh,
Why is it?
woodwards that have outlived their original purpose can decide new purposes for themselves, and they tend to
Okay.
gravitate towards protecting nature. Some of them enter the serve enter into the service of druids, treants,
Sure.
and in this way, I'm sure even a previously evil serving woodward could then serve a good master.
Right. So long as it's, willing.
Again, yeah, so long as it's willing, but again, it still has that unquestioning dedication to its cause to it, and that in of itself can be very intimidating.
Yeah, that is an intimidating, that's a scary thing, right? Something that is silently moving, walking towards you, closer and closer, closer and closer. You do this, it doesn't stop because it has one. I mean, yeah, that, and it and then it walks into a tree and it's gone. I'm sorry, I can't get over that. That's really good.
Yeah, absolutely. You see something in the treetops and it vanishes, and then a moment later it's right up in your face.
Yeah, you turn around and it's spit take, yeah.
My current campaign involves a lot of deals, where the players are constantly trying to barter with their enemies to turn them against each other to see if they can undermine them. You know,
Smart.
one of the first, second ever session, they sold their souls and wheezed their way out of it. It, but
Just
and
right
the most
away.
intim The most intimidating things I've thrown up against them so far are the things that can't be bargained with or don't give them the opportunity to, because it throws them off balance. Normally, every enemy is a potential enemy of their enemy, except the things that can't be bargained with. And the Woodward is a creature like that. And with Fae becoming more and more important in my current campaign, I'm thinking the Woodward's going to make an appearance sometime soon.
I think it should. I definitely think it should. I mean, it's something that, talking about it now, I feel like in the next session, I might, they're in the middle of a dungeon now, but I might just make them accidentally walk through a portal and they're back in the forest. Because I really want them to encounter some of these things, because I mean, that's such a cool way to look at it, I think that the idea too of having it, the versatility of its creation is really limitless, because they are intelligent creatures. Where does the line go? Like, is it possible to make, could they be more intelligent? Could they have more sentience? Could they be, once their master dies, maybe their master taught them something, like it's an intelligent creature, that gives
Well,
you a lot to work with.
that comes down to, something you got to keep in mind with any stat block ever, and that is, any stat block only ever represents an average
Right.
specimen of that species.
Yes.
It's only ever an average specimen, and you can and indeed should customize them however you want.
Yeah.
A woodward that actually knows druid spells would be, I think, really cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Or even if it could just create maybe other, like a woodwode community, right? That's what I'm thinking now. Like, you stumble into a woodwode community of a woad who, because they're immortal, right? They never die, but their creator has long since passed, but they taught him how to make
Hadn't you?
more of him
I
or
hadn't
it.
even considered that.
Yeah, so it could be an entire community of these tree ninjas, and maybe they're drawn to, dryads and treants are drawn to them instead of the other way,
Indeed. I mean, they pair so well with so many creatures like treants, dryads, hags, druids, unicorns, coatl. You know, actually, you know, since we're pushing just how crazy we can get with this, yes. which I always think is a great mental exercise.
Yes, do it.
I mean, what is a forest, really? So a rainforest is a forest. A more temperate oak forest is a forest. Mm-hmm. A snowy tundra is a forest. I don't see why any of these places would be discounted from having woodwards.
Right.
But let's get even more extreme. They're associated with the Feywild through their language proficiency, mm-hmm. Sylvan.
And probably again, because they like ritual that creates them as well. I would assume.
You absolutely could have that. You know, if you wanted an origin for the woodwood ritual in your setting or in your games, you could say, "Oh, I learned it from a wise old Eladrin druid," right. or something like that. Mm-hmm. But I mean, other planes have forests as well. The Shadowfell, parts of the Abyss, are mm-hmm. described as having forests.
Right. Oh, wow. That's a scary
I mean, the Shadowfell has some dark, twisted forest in it.
Hell yeah.
But Demogorgon's plane, a layer of the Abyss. Who else had forests? Oh, Yunogu's kind of area has scant plant coverings. And again, the plants there are described... I'm going to have to look this up. Luckily, I've got my book on my desk. But I do believe his realm is described in such a way that even the plants there have to fight to survive by drinking blood. So in that situation, even a woodward would be perfectly at home, right?
Right.
It's lawful neutral. And again, you still get hags in the Abyss, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
to create these things.
What happens if you put a different creature's heart and perform the woodwork ritual, right? What if it's a minotaur? What if it's a cyclops? What if it's a...
I think that goes beyond the realm of Volo's guide.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I absolutely think it's a really interesting hook for DMs to explore in mm-hmm. their campaigns. Again, if you took the woodwork community idea that you just came up with, which I think is...
Yeah.
Just amazing. And extrapolated, so they were trying to innovate on the ritual even, and create a stronger version of their kind to mm-hmm. properly champion their protection of the forest.
Right.
That's a hook.
Yeah.
I think they have just one other thing I wanna really touch on briefly.
Sure.
Because all undead have this hook to them, even down to the basic zombie
right.
of who this person used to be in life. Undead, with very few exceptions, used to be a person or a creature of some kind, and figuring out who they used to be is a hook inherent to them.
Right.
You can ignore it. You can ignore it. Like with a zombie horde, it might not matter too much. But again, even just one zombie, it might matter who did this used to be.
Mm-hmm.
That's also true with the woodwood. The woodwood is created from a person whose soul was given up to be trapped inside the woodwood to serve a purpose. And how they came to be this way is in itself a story hook.
To extrapolate on that, not to cut you off, but I mean, take something or someone that is important to the players or to the story and turn them into a woodwode. You know, have that hag capture an NPC who was previously adventuring with the party. And, you know, maybe the ritual's fresh and it hasn't, you know, fully set in. It is a woodwoe, but it kind of recognizes you. And, you mm-hmm. know, the party comes to learn that, you know, that used to be their buddy, you know.
Or perhaps it recognizes you. It doesn't want to hurt you, but it is still a slave and has to fight you anyway.
Right, yep. Yeah, it sees the recognition in its eyes, but it's still moving towards you. It's still, you mm-hmm. know, being a... friggin' tree ninja and teleporting.
Yeah.
I still love that.
Exactly. And again, these guys are immortal. So someone who died a very long time ago, if they had important plot information, like they knew where to find the magical artifact or something like that, or they knew the secret portal, the location of secret portal of the Feywild, information like that could be preserved long after their death. So players looking for like this old sage or something, or an old adventurer who got lost in the forest a long time ago, may even meet the woodward and not realize it's exactly who they're looking for.
Wow, yeah, that's great too. I like that a lot. I think that, you know, that's, I think, you know, it's a smart creature. It's got the lore that allows you to be flexible, but also purposeful with the creature. And the stats and abilities, I mean, it is a perfect package. I think it's something that really, really ties everything together. I think that's awesome. I think that's
okay.
Awesome. Yeah. Do you have any things you'd like to say, or?
I mean, I should stop now, or I'd never stop. You know.
Well, you know.
I've covered just about everything I wanted to talk about Woodwards. Mm-hmm.
Great. Yeah. So I want to thank you for taking the time today to talk with me and talk with us. Because you've taught me a lot, and I'm telling you, they're going through a portal next session. I don't care. They're gonna be tree ninjas popping out of the forest.
Underground forest.
Perfect. See? That was another hook. That's a thing. There are underground forests.
Or
right?
Perhaps, I mean, the roots of a tree is still a tree, right? You can still use it to teleport.
Yeah. I would argue. DM rules, yes.
So perhaps they're coming to a chamber that's under the roots of a massive tree on the surface, yeah. And the woodwork uses these really sturdy roots to teleport around.
Yeah, and that's where they that's great. That's super smart. See, it never stops.
It never stops.
Precisely why I wanted to talk with you today, and I want to thank you again for taking the time. Hopefully we can do it again. Hopefully we can do it. With another monster. This was a lot of fun. Like I said, I'm going to put this up on YouTube just so people can see it. I might rip the audio out and put it in a put it on some kind of website too. We'll figure that out. But Morgan, you are wonderful. Your time is valuable, and you are an expert as far as I'm concerned.
Well, you've convinced me. I guess I must be an expert. Yes. And thank you, of course, for having me on.
And everybody, Star Shinobi and Emily, thank you guys for checking this out. And we will, won't be too long before we do this again.